Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Whether you are in the room or online, a blessed rainy Sunday morning to you. And I just want to open and say welcome. And I want to tell you that this morning was different. We gathered for practice at 9:30 to finish getting ready, and the anointing of God was already here. For whatever reason, that is not normal. But today, all of us just felt like something was different. And so I don't know what God wants to do today, but I know what we're going to do, and that is to enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise, and let the Holy Spirit do what the Holy Spirit wants to do. So if you will please stand with me, we are going to open with the new song we sing and move into worship. Heavenly Father, we give you praise. You are worthy of all praise, and I cannot thank you enough, number one, for answered prayer. For you are a God who answers prayer. You are a God who takes care of us. When we humble ourselves before you, you lift us up, just like your word says. And in my simple way of thinking, sometimes I think you just shake your head and say, if they would just trust me. And Lord, this morning, I pray that every person in this room, every person who's watching online, would be like a little child and come to you and trust you and let you do what you want to do today, for you are a good, good Father. And we worship you, we give you thanks and praise, and we invite you, Holy Spirit, to come and have your way here. In the mighty name of Jesus, amen.
Red, by love. We are red, by love.
Bless his holy name. Bless his holy name. Oh, Lord, your name is holy. Your name is worthy. Your name is Yahweh. You are Emmanuel. You are God with us. And you are with us here today. You are here by the power of the cross to meet every need, to heal every wound. You are here to heal every disease. You are Lord and Lord alone, and we will have no other gods before you, Lord. We acknowledge you as the one true living God, the creator of all that is. And how you all did that, I don't know. There's mystery there, but you did. And you have declared yourself to be God. And you have proven it in our lives, Lord, over and over and over again. You do not lead us to blind faith, but you lead us to faith that is based on both your word and on the work that you do in our lives. And we bless your name, O God. Hallelujah.
It was my cross you bore, so I could live in the freedom you died for. And now my life is yours, and I will sing of your goodness forevermore. Worthy is your name.
hearts for communion. Pray that during this next song, just think of Jesus. Praise Him, the immortal. Father, speak.
Thank you.
Transition into our time of communion. Communion is a time of remembrance. We remember our great God. You may be seated. If you haven't gotten your elements, hopefully you picked them up on your way in, but there's some on the table at the back if you want to step back by the sound booth and get your elements. Communion is a time of remembrance, to remember the works of the hands of our God. From the creation to the fall to a plan that was put in place to redeem mankind to himself, to God himself coming down and hanging on a cross, taking my place and taking your place, that we could have peace with him and live eternally. That's what we're going to remember this morning. And, you know, we have a tendency to forget things, don't we? Sometimes I can't remember what I did yesterday. And God knew that. He knew that. That's why we erect memorials. We have war memorials. We have a memorial to law enforcement officers killed in the line of duty. We have a memorial to 9/11. One of the key words and phrases throughout our nation of these things is, lest we forget. We don't want to forget things. And God don't want us to forget. There's 181 references in the Old Testament to remembering. There's 50 references in the New Testament to remembering. God wants us to remember the works of his hands. In Genesis 9, he reminded Noah, and we still see it today, that he will never destroy the earth again by the water. He put that beautiful rainbow in the sky. And when I see it, and I know when you see it, I remember God, the God of the Bible. And he has a covenant with Noah. And he said, Noah, I'm going to give you a sign. And I want you to remember. We'll be taking offering in a minute. Deuteronomy 8, he said, when you give your offering, when you give your money, when you've done well, you remember that it was me that gives you that ability. And in Deuteronomy 9, he reminded the children of Israel how he was stirred to anger because they had created a golden calf. And that worship is for him alone. And finally, in Joshua 4, he tells Joshua, he said, take some stones, Joshua, and when I dry up the Jordan and you come across and make a memorial there, so that when your children ask, what's this about? We can remember, and they can remember and say, this is when God dried up the river so we could come across and fulfill the promise that he had for us. And it's just as important today that we remember our God and what he's done for us. Which leads us to now. Jesus is about to be crucified. He knows it. He's in the upper room with his disciples. He's taking a meal. And he wants them to take it with him. And he says, as often as you do this, do it in remembrance of me. He wants them to remember what's about to happen. And I remember. Every time we do this, I remember. And I don't want it to become so methodical that we forget what this is about. I remember that three things. I remember that forgiveness is costly. In the Old Testament, it cost animals and they were slaughtered and it was a covering for sin. But in the New Testament, in the grace that we live under, it cost the very Son of God his life. Forgiveness is costly. I remember that the punishment due your sin is death. Romans 6:23 says the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. It's death. And when he was dying on that cross, that's where I should have been. That's where you should have been. But he took it. And I remember throughout the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. I don't fully understand that. I don't know why that was God's plan. But I trust it. I've put my faith in it. And I also remember the words of Jesus when he was about to raise Lazarus from the dead. And he said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies. And finally, the words of Paul to the church at Corinth. When he said this, when you eat this bread, when you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And one promise he's given us, and one thing we do and remember when we take this and know that he is coming again. I heard on a news show this morning, apparently the intro to that news show is a trumpet. And when they, in the teaser, the lady said, just listen for the trumpet. I heard that this morning. Well, I tell you, I'm listening for the trumpet. Because I believe it's about to sound. But what we're going to do this morning is remember what's been done for us. We're going to remember when that trumpet sounds and we go out of here, what made us worthy of that. Not our righteousness, not our works, but the precious blood and the broken body of Jesus Christ. That's it. And if you're here this morning and you've never accepted that, or you don't know, today is the day of salvation. Don't leave this place. We don't know what tomorrow holds. You don't know what tomorrow holds. And so as you hold the elements in your hand, if you want to get them prepared, we've got the individual cups. And if you'll just tear off the little top piece, you'll be able to get to the bread. And then peel off the second one, and you'll get to the juice. I don't know what you will remember as you take this. Certainly, we're going to remember what the Lord's done. We're going to remember a broken body, and we're going to remember the blood that was spilled. But maybe as you take it this morning, you'll remember the hope that you have of a loved one who died in the Lord. Maybe you'll remember a healing that came to your body through that blood that still provides for our physical healing. Maybe there's a struggle in your life, and you need certain peace in your life, and you always know that this is where peace comes from. It don't come from the world. Jesus said, I leave a peace not as the world gives. Every promise of God is right here. Is right here. And that's what it represents. So God, we thank you for this. And we thank you that we'll never forget our great God. The God that parted the Red Sea. The God that healed the sick. The God that raised the dead. The God that gave sight to the blind. But most of all, the God that gave salvation. Through you and you alone. God that took on flesh. The only God that makes that claim. God with us, took on flesh, lived amongst us, loved us, went to a cross, died, buried, and rose again, and coming again. Lord, we remember those things this morning as your people. In Jesus' name, would you take the body? And Lord, we remember the blood that was spilled for our sin. In Jesus' name. God bless you, church. I do want to challenge you this morning that if you don't know Christ as your Savior, that today you make that decision. Have some announcements. As I mentioned last week, this month is Pastor Appreciation Month. We want to honor our pastors. I thank God that I had a friend of mine who took a class here with us. We did a financial class a few years ago. And what he said he remembered about being with our people in that class was that we loved our pastor. And so that is a testament to a church, to an outsider, that we love our pastor, because we should honor our pastors and the job that they do here. So we love you, Pastor Don, Sister Carol. But this month is Pastor Appreciation Month. If you want to honor them at any time throughout this month, you can. However, we have, I think it's the 20th, is that right, set up for Pastor Appreciation? Is the 18th? Let me look at my calendar here. Yes, it's the 18th. That's next Sunday. Set aside for Pastor Appreciation Month. So we would encourage you to love them, a card, a call, a financial gift. And let's just let them know how much we appreciate them. And I also want to include Brother Michael and Sister Christy in that. They do a lot of work for our youth. A lot of work. So let's remember them as well and the things that they do for our church. We're going to have a 15-second video here on our Bible plan for the year. So take a look.
God has called your life to be different, washed by the water of the Word. Let's read the Bible together throughout the upcoming year at BethelDurham.com/Bible. And in the meantime, you can join us through the New Testament and check out what we've been doing this year at BethelDurham.com/start now.
Brother Michael will be giving some more information about that as the weeks go on. And then lastly, this Tuesday at 2 o'clock will be the memorial service for Brother Bobby Williams. The visitation is at 1. If you can make it, particularly the visitation, I know some of you work, but maybe if you could swing by and let's show Sister Kay and the family that we love them. We loved Brother Bobby, faithful people, members of this church for a long, long time. And so that's this Tuesday, visitation at 1, and the memorial service will be at 2. Finally, we're going to take up our offering. We're not passing the plate, but we do have our plates out in the foyer, so we trust that you'll do that. And then also, many of you, like myself, give online. Particularly now, sometimes it just makes it easier. Thank you for your faithfulness. You know, there's been a lot of churches that have really suffered in this time, but God has been good to Bethel through this, but he's been good to Bethel through you, through the people. So thank you for your faithfulness in that. God bless you.
Wow. Brother Larry, that was beautiful. Thank you for that wonderful service. We've already had church with that communion service. Thank you for being here today. It's so good to have our guests. So good to have you online that is watching with the stream. But thank you, no matter how or where you're here today, to hear the Word of God, to listen and worship the Lord as we praise Him. I was, by the way, we want everyone to have an outline of the sermon. They're on both sides of the sound booth and on table. Please feel free to go back and get one. We want everyone to have an outline. I could not help but think this week about our vision statement here at the church. And most of us, probably if I'd ask you what is our vision statement, you would say transforming lives through Christ. Transforming lives through Christ. I found out recently there is a university in Rome, Georgia. It is it's called Shorter. I never heard of it. Shorter University. That's their vision statement, transforming lives through Christ. And it's been ever since 1873 that university has been there. And I love this vision statement because it states exactly what you and I and what this church sits here at 3518 Rose of Sharon Road for. It's to transform lives through Christ. Now, John Maxwell said people don't change until, first of all, they hurt bad enough they have to change. Hurt bad enough, they have to change. Or they learn enough, they want to change. And thirdly, people do not change. In fact, a lot of people will never change. They got to hurt bad enough, they certainly got to learn enough that they want to change. And then number three, they receive enough that they're able to change. A lot of people that are bound by all types of sins and addictions, and they don't change. But when you and I take the opportunity that we have to contact people, whether it's online, whether it's phone or whatever, or in person, to introduce them to Jesus Christ, that helps them to change. And we need to see a whole lot of people change. Amen? Maybe you're here today. You say, boy, I have things in my life I sure would like to change. My wife looked at me in the bathroom a few years after we'd been married years ago. I was bound with anger And I made her life, my life, miserable. Her home life was miserable. Maybe your home, maybe your lifestyle needs to be changed. And she looked at me and she said, because I'd always get angry and mistreat her, and then I would say, I'm sorry. She said, one day, I won't put up with this no longer. And I knew she meant business. She means what she says. So I made up my mind to change. And I've been through that over and over many times to you folks, how that God helped me to change from my anger. Do I still get angry? Yes. Does it control me? No. There's a difference. And for a lot of people, anger, jealousy, hate, bitterness, addiction, they need to change, but they're not going to change until they hurt bad enough to change, until they learn enough they want to change, or they receive enough. And I think attached to that is receive the Holy Spirit, receive Jesus Christ, because he works from the inside out, and he helps us to change. If I'd ask you today, many of you would raise your hand and you said, I've changed. And you could describe ways in which you've changed your life through and by Jesus Christ. Transforming lives through Christ. The glory of the cross. The glory of the cross. Almost all men have something wherein to glory. Physical strength, religion, money, family, talents, position, social status, fame, or even some glory in their knowledge. Paul, writing to the church at Galatia, said in Galatians chapter 6, verse 14, but God forbid that I should boast, King James says there, God forbid that I should glory, except what? In the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me and I to the world. In other words, my interest in this culture, in the things that the world has to offer me, and it should be for every believer, has been crucified on the cross, and it no longer draws me into it to commit sin and disobedience. I've got to read it again. Galatians 6:14, for God forbid that I should boast or glory except in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world has been crucified to me, and I to the word. Father, add your blessings to the reading of your word. Speak not only to our ears, but speak to our hearts. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 3, it talks about vainglory. Vainglory. I'm reminded of many in the Bible that they had something to glory in. I'll give you three examples, two from the Old Testament and one from the New Testament. First of all, the son of David, Absalom. Listen to what it says about Absalom. Now, if you want to know a little bit about Absalom, he'd be on the cover of GQ magazine, because listen to what it says about him. Now, in all Israel, there was no one who was praised as much as Absalom for his good looks. Wow. Woo. From the sole of his foot to the crown of his head, there was no blemish in him, had no teenage acne. Goes on to say about him, listen to this guy. And when he cut the hair of his head at the end of the year, he cut it because it was heavy on him. When he cut it, he waited. He thought so much of his hair until when he cut it at the end of the year, he waited. Oh, my God, look at this. Beautiful hair. It weighed 2 pounds. 2 pounds of hair. And he gloried in that. He gloried in that. But something happened to Absalom. He stood at the gate. Now, this is David, the king's son. And he would go to the people and said, I was king, and if you got a problem, I could solve your problem. He rebelled against his dad. Treason took place, and he marshaled an army. And it's a long story, but he and his army was defeated by David and his army. Joab was the head of David's army, and the Bible said that Absalom was riding his mule. I didn't study that. I thought he would ride a stallion, but he was riding a mule. Absalom was riding a mule, and he went under a tree, and his hair got caught in the limbs of the tree. The mule went running on down the road, and here was Absalom hanging between heaven and earth. Hanging by the very thing that he was the most proud of. Let me tell you something. If you allow pride to rule your life, it will hang you. It will destroy you. Joab comes along and sees him and cuts him to pieces. Awful, awful death. Someone else that was filled with pride, and most of us have heard of Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon. He was so filled with pride. He was walking in his beautiful castle. And he said, look at me. Look at all of this Babylon that I have built. And he bragged and bragged and bragged about his glory, about his strength. The greatest man at that time in the world. When he did that, God said, okay, I can bring you down. Listen, we never get too high that God can't make us cry uncle. You let pride rule your life and God will tap you on the shoulder. I said, wait a minute, you're not God. You're not God. He lost his mind. Nebuchadnezzar did. They put him out of the castle, put him out of his kingdom. He went out into the fields and the dew and dampness. He was, the Bible says, his hair was like eagle's feathers. His nails were like bird claws. And for 7 years, he was isolated. Can you imagine? Every one of these that were full of pride, whether it's Absalom or Nebuchadnezzar or the next person I'm going to, they just went through awful things in their life. And here Nebuchadnezzar, that walked with pride in his kingdom, is brought down to the lowness of an animal. And the Bible says he was eating grass like an animal. Hair like feathers. Claws like bird claws. It's amazing. But something happened to him. God was gracious to Nebuchadnezzar. He gave him back his mind. He restored him back into the kingdom. And something happened so wonderfully to this man. In fact, I'd like for us to hear something. Brother Matt, would you do something for me? You have a good, strong voice. You have your Bible there. Would you read something for me? Would you read Daniel chapter 4? Verses 34 through 36. And Daniel chapter 4, verses 34 through 36. Now listen, when God gets a hold of us, when God reveals himself to us, and shows what kind of person we really are. And opens our eyes. And that's what we need to pray for America today. That America's eyes need to be open. Washington's eyes need to be open. The leadership of America, their eyes need to be open. And then here's what happens to you. Listen at this man. Now being that God has brought him humbly down.
But at the end of those days, I, Nebuchadnezzar, looked up to heaven, and my sanity returned to me. Then I praised the Most High God and honored and glorified him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom is from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are counted as nothing, and he does what he wants with the army of heaven and the inhabitants of the earth. There is no one who can hold back his hand or say to him, "What have you done?" At that time, my sanity returned to me, and my majesty and splendor returned to me for the glory of my kingdom. My advisors and my nobles sought me out. I was reestablished over my kingdom, and even more greatness came to me.
Amen. Thank you. Listen, when God sees us as we humble ourselves, he will reestablish us and make us what we need to be. He honored God. He honored Jehovah. Absalom, Nebuchadnezzar. There's a little couple of verses over in the book of Acts, chapter 12. Look at it. So on a set day, Herod. Now I want you to understand who this is. It's Herod Agrippa. It's the same Herod that had James killed and Peter put in prison. Arrayed in royal apparel, sat on his throne and gave an oration, to them. And the people kept shouting. Now listen to what they said. The voice of a God, not a man. Then immediately an angel of the Lord struck him because he did not give glory to God. When we try to take God's glory, no matter who we are, preachers, laymen, politicians, no matter, one day we will fall. One day pride will go take us down. But listen to what it says. And he was eaten by worms and died. He was eaten by worms and died. Josephus, the first century historian, describes his death. I won't go into it this morning on Sunday morning. I don't know if our stomachs could take it or not. You ought to read the history of what happened to Herod Agrippa, because he took glory for that that belongs to God. Paul had a rich choice in which he could have glorified religion. Philippians 3, 4, and 6. Though I also might have confidence in the flesh, if anyone else thinks he may have confidence in the flesh, I more so. Circumcised the eighth day, of the stock of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. Concerned in the law, he says, I was a Pharisee. He kept the law. Notice what he says, concerning zeal, persecuting the church, concerning the righteousness which is in the law, blameless. Oh, he could have bragged on that, but he didn't. He did not. He could have bragged on his religion. He could have bragged on his suffering. Look at 2 Corinthians. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. In labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequently, in deaths often, verse 24. From the Jews five times I received 40 stripes minus one. Three times I was beaten with rods. Once I was stoned, three times shipwrecked. A night and a day I've been in the deep. In journeys often, in perils of water, perils of robbers, perils of my own countrymen. In perils of the Gentiles, perils of the city, wilderness, in perils of the sea, in perils among all false brethren. Then in verse 27, in weariness and toil, sleeplessness often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. And then last verse, besides the other things. Besides the other things which come upon me daily. My deep concern for all the churches. Paul could have gloried in his suffering. Oh, I've suffered for the Lord. I live in this world and it's so against me. We could sit around and moan and groan, and we could sit around and testify to the fact. Paul said, I don't want to talk about any of those things. I'm going to leave those things behind. He could have gloried in his visions. In his visions. 2 Corinthians 12. It is doubtless not profitable for me to boast. I will come to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago, whether in the body, I do not know, or whether out of the body, I do not know, God knows, such a one was called up to the third heaven. He had visions. He has experiences. He had revelation. Paul said, I'm not going to glory in these things. Listen to what it says. But when he was converted in Philippians chapter 3, he says, whatever was gain, I now count for loss. What is he glorying in? Notice these things. Number 5, Paul did not say he gloried in Christ. He did not say he gloried in the incarnation. He did not say he gloried in the life of Christ, the resurrection of Christ. He didn't even say he gloried in the return of Christ. He said he gloried in the cross of Christ. I love that. I love that. It's amazing to me how many churches, even evangelical churches, that are taking the cross out of the church because they are ashamed of it or because they don't want to offend someone. But Paul held it up high and said, I glory in the cross of Jesus Christ. He selected beyond all things the center of Christianity, and it is. Can you say amen? I thank God for the cross. Notice, if you will, what did Paul mean by the cross? The fact of the cross. Josh McDowell, if you read his book, it says, not a hoax, but the cross and the resurrection was a reality. It is history that these things took place. The doctrine of the cross. And I love this probably more than as much as anything in this on this paper, if you'll notice it with me. What is the doctrine of the cross? Atonement, sacrifice. This is a great one. Justification. I love that word. Justification. You and I, through the cross, through the blood of Jesus Christ, have been justified. Me, a sinner that should die and go to hell, I've been justified. You have been justified. Reconciliation. What have we been reconciled? We've been reconciled back to have what? A relationship with Jesus Christ and the redemption. Not only the doctrine of the cross, but the cross of the doctrine. We preach Christ crucified. The Jews are offended and the Greeks say nonsense. I'm like Larry this morning said. I don't know why. I don't know. I don't understand all that. I don't understand why. But I do know this. I do know this. That Christ gave himself. And it's not nonsense. It's the foundation of my and your belief. If someone would check the heat or the cooling here and see if I'm hot, maybe someone else are hot. I think that's the reason we get a little sleepy. Lights last week, now the heat this week. I'm going to keep you awake one way or the other. Look at number 4. Follow it with me. Let's not lose it. Let's get this message, folks. Why did Paul glory in the cross? Listen at me. Listen at me. Why did Christ or Paul glory in the cross? It was a vindication of divine justice. You see, nothing would satisfy a holy God for my and your sins and ungodliness. The only thing that would was the cross of Jesus Christ. It satisfied it. Amen? Did we turn on the air? Did it come on? Some of you know I take shots and I have hot flashes like a woman. True story. My wife just solved my problem. I got too much pride to take off my coat. I'm preaching on pride, and I go in and take my coat off. Look at number four again. A display of God's love. Please don't let this get us away from the sermon. A display of God's love. God showed his love toward us while we were yet sinners. What did Christ do? He died for us. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad? A removal, and I love this one, a removal of all guilt. One of the worst things to have to deal with is the guilt of sin. You remember before you were saved, how heavy, how terrible it was, that weight of sin. But God, through the cross, Jesus Christ, he forgives us and removes that guilt. It is a door of hope, even to the vilest and the most sinful of people. Jesus Christ forgives and cleanses. It's a door of hope, even to the vilest of the vile. It is a source of power, and it changes us. For the message of the cross, Paul wrote, is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is a what? Power of God. And I know we receive power when we receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We receive power when we receive the Spirit. But understand, all of this comes from the cross of Jesus Christ. I thank God for the cross. Ending with this as they come to provide music, what was the effect on him? What was the effect on the Apostle Paul? The message and the doctrine of the cross. The cross is never without influence. Let me hear you say amen. The cross is never without influence. If you preach the cross, if you preach Jesus Christ, if you live the message, if you allow the gospel to be number one in your life, it will influence people around you. Maybe your lifestyle, or maybe whatever you do, maybe whatever you have, beautiful church and everything else, but the cross and the message of the gospel will change people's life. It worked for life, or it works for death. Paul said, as he finished this, he said, for me, this old world has been crucified. I no longer allow the culture to influence my life. Why? Because it's crucified. I'm crucified to the world, and the world is crucified. Oh, the cross of Jesus. Oh, the blood. The blood will never lose its power. Listen as they provide for us a song. Now worship the Lord and appreciate the price that Jesus Christ gave for us. Streams of grace flow deep and wide. Lord, I owe to you.
I owe to you, Jesus.
Ilarabashatayana bakata. Glory be to the Holy Lamb of God. Sin and shame are powerless. Aren't you glad you've got peace with God today? Comes like a flood, comes flowing. Stand and sing it. At the cross. Now, Father, we come this morning and we thank you for the cross of Calvary. We thank you for the price that was paid for our sins and our redemption. Lord, we're so thankful that you brought us and bought us back. God, we no longer have sin tied around our neck. We no longer, Lord, flounder around in a pit that is filled with decay. We no longer, dear God, are ruled by pride. We no longer, God, are ruled by the things of this world. But the cross, because of the crucified Savior, has been given to us to crucify this old world. And we thank you. Search our hearts here today. Let not one man, one person, one woman leave this place today not knowing you as their personal Savior. Deal with every heart and every life. Lord, if there's a weight or a sin, if there's something, dear God, that we've been struggling with for the last while, we ask you, God, to set us free. Make us whole. Help us, dear God, to understand that the ground at the foot of the cross is level. And help us to be willing to kneel at that cross and be forgiven in Jesus' name. Amen. Sing it again. Would you come and stand around the altar? I'll have plenty of time for us to spend some time in prayer. Sing it one more time. Feel free to come. I'm in all of you. Come on, everyone, let's come. There's plenty of space. the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day. At last, and did my Savior bleed, and did my sovereign die, that he devote that sacred head for such a worm as. Sing it out, at the cross. Oh, at the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy. Oh, sing that chorus again. Oh, at the cross. Brother Matt said as they practiced this morning that the Spirit of God was so prevalent in the church. And I don't think it, I know he's still here. And he's not here just to be here. Yes, he's here. There are three dimensions of the presence of the Lord. He is omnipresent. He's everywhere. You can't go anywhere that his Spirit is not there. Number two is his abiding presence. When we accept Jesus Christ, he comes on the inside and he abides. So his presence is always with you. No matter where you feel like it or don't feel like it, 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock in the morning, no matter when it is, God's presence is with you. And then thirdly, the other dimension of his presence is his manifested presence. And that's what he wants in this service today. You're here, you need to be changed. And if you do, and God will change you. He will touch you. He'll make you new. If you don't know him, I want you to know him. If you know him, but you're struggling with something in your life and you need to lay it down, Hebrews said, lay aside every weight. And what? The sin that so easily besets us. What's in your life? Are you struggling with something? Let's pray right now. Let's believe God right now. Holy Spirit of God, we know that you are here. You said where two or three are gathered together, you would be in the midst. So we have your promise that you're here. We have your word, dear God, that you are here. And then, Lord, we pray that your Holy Spirit would be manifested, that you would touch hearts and lives. Move them by your Spirit. Touch them through the Holy Spirit. Do a work in their life. We pray against every bondage. We pray against every chain. We pray against every sin. We pray against every addiction. We pray against the enemy that would try to destroy God's people. And we pray, God, for right now, for total and free deliverance in Jesus' name. And everybody says, if you have a special need and you want us to pray specifically for you, just lift your hand and we're going to come in agreement with you. The Bible says if two, now he didn't say any two could be two drunks on the street. He means believers. If two of you agree is touching any one thing, it shall be done. If you have a need, just lift that hand. All right, I guess we all doing good. Amen. Praise God. Are you raising your hand or stretching? You raise your hand? Some of you girls step back there. She raised her hand and we want God to minister. Anybody else? Come on. That's good. If you have a need, lift that hand. Okay. Step back there and pray. Did you find that song at the cross? All right, we're going to pray. We're going to believe the Lord. All right, let's all of us, come on, let's all of us join together for these needs, because God answers prayer. Come on, slip up that hand right now and believe the Lord. Father, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, God, you know what's in that heart. You know the need and the concern. And God, if they're concerned, you're concerned. And we're concerned. And we pray, God, that you would touch that individual life spiritually, physically, emotionally, whatever the need might be. God, minister in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Sing it out. Oh, of Jesus. Singing over the land of Jesus. Hallelujah. I want to thank you for coming. Brian, it's so good to see you. Hallelujah. You out of the service? Not yet. God bless you. Amen. Well, it's good to have you. Thank you for coming this morning. Jason, you feel better. I understand. You feel better. Praise God. So good to see you. Amen. You know that lady back there, Sister Carol? I didn't even know you. She came years ago. God, I can't think of her name. Joy, you are so sweet. Monica, how can I forget your name? It is so good to see you. Tell us how you're doing. Introduce us to your husband. Would you praise God for this life? She is so precious. You're talking about seeing people's lives change. We've seen, Brother Dan, we've seen thousands and thousands of people's lives change. Young men and young women that changed. A young man came in one Saturday night. God saved him. He was a throwaway. God saved him, cleaned him up, and he's now preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Many, many people have changed. And I thank God for the change. It's so good to see all of you. Thank you for coming today. Father, we love you this day. Thank you for the rain. Our flowers needed rain. Our gardens needed rain. Thank you for your blessings. Keep us in your care. Go with us, and we'll thank you in Christ's name. And everybody.